colloquium. These have been going on with some regularity for over 10 years, with an invited speaker, sometimes from very far away, as happened a few years ago when we invited a speaker from China, and sometimes from right next door. And today, we're going to have a colloquium from a speaker with Harvard connections, going back to graduate school, but who is up in Dartmouth, where he teaches in two different departments, both the history department and the astronomy and physics department. Rich Kremer studied 19th century German history in his thesis here and worked on that quite a while, but more recently has gone back and is working on 16th century astronomy. That's, I'm happy to say, part of my influence on him in the days when he was in one of my classes here. He is also their curator of scientific instruments at Dartmouth, which has a large collection of early instruments, which is second only to the Harvard collection of historical scientific instruments.
But I'm going to say something about
that. He's been working on calendars from the 1500s to see, for example, whether they take any notice of Copernicus, which is a level of sort of popular writing that hasn't been really explored before. And it's very interesting to see to what extent people are introducing some of the astronomical computations of Copernicus. And by the way, it's possible to do those calculations without accepting a heliocentric system. So he may have something to say about that, but I think mostly today he's going to tell us some of the interesting history of early telescope mountings. And rather than taking any more time away from him, let me turn it over right now to Rich Kremer.
Well, thank you very much, Owen.
Carry on.
Well, so Harvard has a bigger collection than we do. You have about 20,000 objects, and we have about 5,000 objects. But our collection is what I call a pure collection. Your collection is what I call an impure collection, in that over the years, Harvard purchased things. So you were trying to do sort of soup to nuts history of science in your collection, so you have Islamic astrolabes and abacuses from China that had nothing to do with Harvard. Whereas Dartmouth's collection is all about science that was done at Dartmouth. And so if you want to do the history of science at an American college / university, you probably don't go to Harvard, you come to Dartmouth, because our collection is a better sort of snapshot of that over time. At least that's what I tell my students to make them feel better when they hear that you guys have so many more instruments than we do. Well, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to give this talk. I think that when historians of science get together, we generally say that astronomers have more interest in the history of their field than any of the other sciences. A biologist doesn't care about the history of biology, a chemist doesn't care about the history of chemistry, but somehow you guys do. Maybe because you study the history of the universe, I don't know. But in any case, this is a long-standing, I think, trend that astronomers care about their history. And that's nice because I do the history of this astronomy. So what I want to do is to give you a kind of preliminary report on a project that I have started about 18 months ago after I spent some time in Tartu, in Dorpat, in Estonia, and was able to see this restored telescope. The first German mount, it was called a giant refractor. It has about a 12-inch opening on its lens there. And raised the question as to how this kind of technological innovation happened. And in particular, what I want to explore is what is the relationship between the instrument builder and the astronomer? As you're working back and forth, trying to solve problems, trying to develop new ways of building apparatus. That's sort of the project that I went to look at. And I've just started work on this, so this is kind of a preliminary report rather than a finished report. I've not been in the archives yet. I've looked mostly just at the published material. So let me take you back to 1824, when Frederick Wilhelm Struve published his description of his new telescope. He actually put a color plate in the 1825 book. It's very rare to find a color plate in a book that early. He was so proud of this that the Russian king gave him the money to publish this. And he gave a description of the arrival of this telescope into Dorpat, which is way up in the north on the Baltic Sea. It's very close to Kaliningrad, Königsberg, in Russia now. So on the 10th of November, 1824, 22 boxes arrived in Dorpat coming from Munich, where the telescope was made. They weighed 5,000 Russian pounds. That's about 2,500 kilograms were in these boxes. It arrived without instructions. There was nothing except a drawing, and I'll show you the drawing at the end, of what the thing should look like. But Struve was so excited about getting this thing that he couldn't wait for the instructions to come. So he put it together without instructions. And in 2 weeks, by the 15th of November and the early 16th of November in 1824, he observed the moon and some double stars. And it's very important to see that he's looking at double stars. And he wrote then, published this very enthusiastic report about his first observations and about his new instrument. Now, what's interesting is that this was one of the largest objectives that was then made. As I said, it was 9 pairs of inches. That's about 24 centimeters. And he said almost nothing about the objective in his report. What he said was that the counterweights perfectly balance the tube in every situation. It may be turned in declination with a finger, and around the polar axis with still less force. This enormous telescope can be brought into any position against the horizon with greater speed and certainty than any other telescope. So the counterweights. And then he talked about the clock. This is the first telescope that had a clock drive. The most perfect motion around the polar axis is produced by a clockwork and is the greatest triumph of the instrument. So it wasn't the glass. It was the clockwork that was the greatest triumph. The mechanism is as simple as it is ingenious. A weight, and unfortunately, here's the clockwork. You can't see it on this picture. It's on the other side. A weight hanging from a projection connected to an endless screw overcomes the friction of the machine. A clock with the balance wheel regulates the motion by driving an endless screw attached to a second wheel in the above projection. The weight of the clock and that of the friction may be wound without interrupting the motion. When the telescope is thus set into motion, a star, even when magnified 700 times, will remain quietly in the center of the field. No vibration, no shaking is noticed. It seems as if we were observing an immovable sky with the telescope. And then he concludes, I am thus inclined to consider our achromat as the most perfect Kunstwerk der Optik, the most perfect artwork of optics ever made, was his celebration of this. Well, the first observations he took with this were double stars. He was able to get very, very small separations. Herschel had been measuring double stars since the 1780s, and Herschel divided the double stars into 5 classes. And anything closer than 5 arc seconds for Herschel was sort of guesswork as to how far apart they were. And Struve said with this apparatus, he was able to measure separations down to 1.3 arc seconds of double stars. He says, these micrometer measurements seem to praise even more the imperishable Kunstwerk of the instrument, since Herschel had almost never applied his micrometer unless the distance was greater than 5 arc seconds. Well, what I want to suggest is that the counterbalances, the counterweights, and the clockwork made this instrument special because it reduced a major reverse salient in large telescopes that had emerged out of the 18th century. And what an equatorial mount allowed astronomers to do was to spend more time with their instruments, with their observations, than they could when they were simply doing transit measurements. The 18th century was almost all transit measurements, where you simply watch things go across the transit and you push a button, you're doing timing and you're measuring angles. You couldn't look at anything that way. An equatorial mount lets you become familiar with things. So what I want to do is talk about these two concepts. First, my sort of analytical tools, reverse salience and familiarization. Then we're going to look at 17th century and 18th century telescope mounts for large telescopes, look at the kind of experimentation that was done trying to solve this problem, making equatorial mount, and then look finally at some of the details of this mount and to ask why it merited this kind of attention. And then I should point out, just to tell you about my last slide now, that if you've been and looked in the dome right across the way, you have this same telescope from 20 years later mounted, right? Meritz and Mailer, who were the continuation of the firm of Fraunhofer, are going to, for the bonds, make the same telescope. And we have the same mount also that was made by Meritz and Mailer up at Dartmouth. And that's what also got me started on this project, is that some of my colleagues were cleaning out one of our observatory buildings, and they found this big chunk of sort of metal. And they said, what is this? It's about a piece this big. And, you know, it had counterweights and sort of stuff laying around. And I recognized that was a Meritz mount. That was our original Meritz mount that we bought in 1848. You got yours in 1846. And that started me thinking about the mounts. Okay, but to come back to this question about how to think about how technology changes. Well, this is the famous clock. So, Owen, we were just looking at the clock, the reproduction clock that you have. And we'll look at this in more detail. But this little piece, it's a box about this big, is the first clock drive that worked. And that's what made Struve very, very excited. Okay, so how does technology evolve? And what can we use from historians of technology to look at this question of big telescopes? Well, I want to take the notion of salience and reverse salience from the historian of technology, Thomas Hughes. Hughes was at MIT and did some very famous studies sort of in the 1990s of the development of early technological systems, like the beginning of the airplane, or he's most famous for electrical systems technology, so Edison, or people in London or people in Berlin who were in the 1880s, 1870s, developing electricity that they can sell to consumers. And what he argued was that to have the most technology is not simply one gadget that's going to change, but it's part of a system. And for the technology to advance, to develop, the whole system has to advance at the same time. There has to be what Hughes says, a harmonious and efficient interaction among all the components. And when that doesn't happen, you have salience or reverse salience. Now that's military language. Think World War I with the trenches set up and you know the Germans coming one way and the British coming the other way. And what you don't want in your trench is something like this. So on the top is a salient where one part of your troops get out ahead of the others, right? Now that's not so good because people over here, here's the enemy, can shoot you in the back. So this is a dangerous place. Hughes' classic example here is the internal combustion engine and the airplane. So diesel has engines working by the 1880s, and it's going to take, you know, till 1905 until the Wright brothers build their plane, right? There you had an example of a salient. You want to make an airplane, it is 1903, right, but it goes better by 1905. You have the example of sort of an airplane is going to need a lot of things. It's going to need power, so it's going to need that internal combustion engine, but it's going to need all these other things as well. And what happened in this story is you had the engine first, and so if you're going to make an airplane, you have to reduce these salients. In other words, you have to figure out how to do a fuselage, how to do wings, et cetera, to make this system so they're all sort of lined up. Then you can get this efficient interplay, and you can get the thing to work. But more common what you have in a technological system, according to Hughes, is a reverse salient. Now, if you're military, this is really scary, right? So that here is the enemy, right? This is your troop, so this is the English moving toward Berlin, and here is a real tough little section where the Germans are tough. But now look what they can do. The Germans can shoot you in the back here, and they can shoot you in the back here. So reverse salience is what you don't want. And this, a little reverse salient, you might change the metaphor, call it a bottleneck, is also something that can keep a technological system from developing. The example that Hughes used here was, again, selling electric power, where you get the generator, you get the labor, you get the lamps, you get the fuel, sort of all of that. But then you have to have some way to do long-distance transmission. When Edison started selling electricity in New York, he had a power plant every half a mile because he could not transmit his direct current electricity longer than a half a mile. So he had to build, in Manhattan, all these power plants. Well, that is a major reverse salient. And so you need to figure out how to do transmission of electricity. Then you can get the system to develop. And that's going to be Tesla. And Tesla reduces this reverse salient, and you get the kind of electrical systems. So that's one of the ideas I want to use about thinking about telescopes and to suggest that these big 18th century telescopes already, which are nothing compared to what we have now, need to be thought of as technological systems. So that it's not just a glass, it's not just an objective, or it's not just a mount, but if you're going to do astronomy with this technology, you need to worry about all of these things. So you've got to have some kind of light collector, either glass, or they were making mirrors in the 18th century. Herschel made these big, massive speculum mirrors. Speculum's a really bad idea, right? Especially if you're in England with all the moisture. You can't keep it polished. And so you have to figure out ways to take this thing out and repolish it all the time if you're using speculum metal. Then you've got to have optical theory to know how to design your optical system. You've got to have eyepieces. You've got to have the mount in some way to measure where you are with your local horizon. You've got to be able to measure angles very precisely. You need to know something about time. You need to have a way to keep the weather away. So buildings and seeing conditions, which means don't do this in the UK, but they did. You need to be able to have the bodies interact with the telescope. And in fact, some of these big telescopes, how you would have the observer sort of physically work with his body was actually a problem that you had to figure out how to do. And so that is part of the system. Then, of course, data collection, data reduction, et cetera, archives, and then dealing with error. All of those things is part of the technological system I want to suggest for a big telescope. And what I want to look at is cases where the mounts are going to become the big reverse salient. Okay, the second sort of theoretical tool I use to think about this problem is this notion of familiarization. And let me introduce you to this wonderful book. I don't know if you've had a chance to see it. It was published about 2 or 3 years ago by, I think it was Chicago, by Omar Nissim, called Observing by Hand. And it's a wonderful study of the earliest observations, or trying to sort out what the spiral nebulae were, and how you observe them, and then how you record them, and then finally how you print it, right? So this is the first publication of M51 as it appeared in Field Trans. And what Omar Nissim did was to go back and look at Lord Rosse's notebooks, look at his books, the drawings he took at the telescope, then look at how he sort of fudged it, put together his picture at his desk, and then finally they had to bring in the engraver and do the engraving. In other words, it's how you produce this kind of picture, and you don't produce a picture like this with things moving over your transit very quickly, right? You can't see it very long. Now, Lord Rosse only had a transit telescope, right? These are two of the most iconic images of big telescopes. This is from the 18th century, the so-called 20-footer that Herschel had. And then Lord Rosse's Leviathan. This is a 1.8 meter lens, mirror at the bottom here, made out of speculum. He had two of them, so you could actually shift them back and forth. So he was always polishing. One of them always had to be in the workshop being polished so that you could then use it. Anyway, these things, this was an altitude azimuth rotation. Here you could only move in the meridian. And so both of these people would have difficulty looking very long at their object before the sky is going to move by. Well, what Nissim suggests is he says, familiarization is a way of coming to terms with what can be made out only after a long period of time spent with an object. And the only way to do that, of course, is to make an equatorial mount so that you can follow the sky. These transit kind of devices or these alt azimuth mounts are not going to let you do that. Okay, so those are the kind of issues that I want to use to think about my story. So here is the first equatorial mount for a reflector. This is not until 1840, so it's 20-some years after the Dorpat system. And this was by the private astronomer William Lassell, who had his own little observatory. And he won an award from the Royal Astronomical Society for this. And John Herschel read the award, and this is describing a reverse salient. This was already a considerable step, this equatorial mount, and forms an epoch in the history of the astronomical use of the reflecting telescope. Only those who've had the experience of annoyance of having to keep an object in view for a long time, especially with high magnifying powers, and in the micrometrical measurements with a reflector mounted in the usual manner, having merely an attitude and azimuth motion, can duly feel and appreciate the advantage thus gained. So John Herschel is saying this is a revolution and that this lets you now spend time with your target object, as opposed to having it go by so quickly. Okay, so let's look at some of the, use this notion of reverse salient and look at 18th century telescopes. And just to sort of orient us in the history of astronomy, here's a nice sort of quantitative measure of how positional astronomy, this is the kind of transit measurements, is moving as a function of time. This number one is measuring the precision of the angle measurements that you can make, starting from some point here, again, just showing change. Number two is the number of positions that you had measured. Number three is the number of observatories. And number four is the number of published star catalogs. And what you can see is that in this period, sort of right here, is where you get a takeoff. This is when astronomy as a discipline is starting to flourish. And it's this period that I'm looking at to try to see what their reverse salients are. What were the problems that they were trying to solve, that they're going to get solved in some way to let these curves go and the field to explode in the 19th century? Well, one of the standard ones that has been well studied is the problem of simply the angle measurements. How do you measure to arc seconds when you're measuring angles? And one way to do that, of course, is to make the circles bigger and then to divide them very carefully. And the dividing engine invented by Jesse Ramsden in the 1760s is going to be a way to do that. There's Ramsden with his dividing engine. You can see this engine, by the way, at the Science Museum in London next time you're there. Pardon me? That's the painting is 1790, but he invented this in the 1760s, right? He probably did not quite look that way. So here's an example of one of these big circles. This is again something that Ramsden made. It's an alt azimuth, right? So you can rotate it around the azimuth. You can rotate it in altitude, and then it's got this big circle, and he's going to divide that circle to 10 arc seconds. And so with his dividing engine, they were able to sort of reduce this reverse salient, if you will, of how to make the angle measurements. And you can see the impact of that. The dividing engine is going to come in about here. So this is, again, how accurately could scales be divided back in Copernicus's time? About 10 arc seconds. By Tycho Brahe, it gets to a minute. He could divide some of his instruments more precisely than that. Hevelius goes up to half a minute. And then we go into the 19th century. So this is an example of how the problem of the dividing a meridian circle, that reduced salient gets reduced as you move into the 19th century. But what about this question of mounts? So I'm not going to talk about the question of glass and making lenses. Again, that's sort of well known, especially when Dahlen figures out a way to make an achromatic lens. That's helpful. But I want to look at this at the question that nobody looks at because mounts sound boring, and how people thought about trying to find an equatorial mount starting back in the 17th century. Again, this is not going to be an exhaustive survey, but I'm trying to get a sense as to what reverse salients were realized and how people tried to reduce those in their mount technology. Well, so I think one of the first observing instruments that has an equatorial mount, there were sort of pedagogical instruments that were equatorially mounted going back to the Middle Ages. But the first one that was used for doing science, as opposed to pedagogy, was Christoph Scheiner, who you perhaps remember as being a big opponent. He was a Jesuit, a big opponent of Galileo on a number of fronts, and they had a number of fights about sunspots. And so one of the issues is how do you record sunspots and how do you draw sunspots? Galileo would sort of look through his static telescope and project it and try to draw the dots. What Scheiner did, and it was actually made by one of his Jesuit colleagues, Greenberger, was to do an equatorial mount and a little telescope here to focus in the sun, and then you had a piece of paper here, and you could then track the sun as the sun moves in the ecliptic, and you could draw the dots. Now, what you could do with this is that it meant that this horizontal line on the paper was the line on the sun that goes through the ecliptic. And it turns out that was one of the issues that Galileo and Scheiner were fighting about. What Scheiner realized is the actual path of the sun, which means that the solar axis on which the sun rotates is tipped from the ecliptic by 7 degrees. And Galileo thought that was not the case. Galileo thought that it was parallel. So Galileo's sunspots in his diagrams go straight across the sun as the sun rotates. And these were tipped. So Galileo did not have this mount. And Shiner writes that he called it a heliotropium telescopium, a sun moving telescope, would let him be more precise in this. And this turned out to be a big debate in terms of whether the sun's axis was tilted or not in trying to find physical evidence for Copernicanism. But I don't have time to go into that now. Well, this looks like it was successful for Shiner. People generally believed him that there was the tilt. But then he got attacked by Hevelius, and the equatorial mount sort of went away. So in Hevelius's big book on the moon, the Selenographia, that was published in 1647, he talks about Shiner's mount, because Hevelius also made sunspot observations. And he says what's nice about this is that the same person can do this. With the equatorial mount, one person can rotate the axis and can also draw the dots. You don't have to have two people. That's management of people in the system, right? One person can do both of these things. But he says that Hevelius says, I've invented something that he says is far easier and quicker than Shiner's, as anyone who's tried each case will acknowledge. That's all he says. Now, when I look at this, I don't quite see how Hevelius could claim this. But what he has is a kind of ball joint. So this is a sphere, a kind of copper sphere that's stuck in the wall. And so this can be moved anywhere, right? There's no constraints at all by axes. And then he has a horizontal kind of bench here that you can turn these gears and move the piece of paper up and down. And then you physically sort of put your hand on this and slide this to follow the sun as you're following the sun to get the sunspots. And he says this is easier and quicker than Shiner's mount. Now, I don't know if he actually tried to build Shiner's mount or not. But this criticism sort of made Shiner's mount go away. And as far as I know, nobody else tried it in this time until we get to Hooke. So Hevelius did his moon book in 1647, and then in 1673, he published a famous book on sort of all of his instruments. Hevelius probably had the biggest observatory, before when Greenwich was founded. They had a lot of apparatus. Hevelius is going to get sort of the same kind of apparatus about the same time. So he published this book advertising all of his instruments. And one of the big illustrations was this famous sextant that's mounted that shows Hevelius's wife and Hevelius, and they're measuring angles between stars. And you're supposed to be able to track the sky as the sky's moving with this thing. And Hevelius says he can do it. Well, Robert Hooke, who was the experimenter for the Royal Society, thought this was crazy. And he wrote a very strong attack on this. I'm quoting now. I need not spend time to show how many inconveniences there are with these hand screws to be managed by two observers at the least. They are indeed so many inconveniences so great that it was not without very good reason that he so often appeals to experience, Hevelius. For the truth is, there was a great need for long practice and much experience to be able to make an observation for that in the turning of any one of these screws is going to have an influence on everything else, so that not just one screw could be turned, but the whole instrument was put out of its situation. And both objects being continuously in motion, the whole instrument was to be rectified at every moment. This is heavy. And so you have these screws that's suspended on chains. Anyway, Hooke says the only way to do this is long practice and experience. Right? Maybe he could get some measurements. They're trying to take measurements to less than a minute of angle with this kind of apparatus here. And Hooke says he just doesn't believe it. Well, so he proposed a solution by saying, let's mount this equatorially. Whoops. Here we are. And this was Hooke's famous suggestion in 1674 for taking this sextant and rather than hanging it on chains, putting it on an equatorial mount. So this, he says, a very stiff piece of wood goes down into this kind of pit down here. And he also added a clock to it in his design. Very clever clock. We don't have time to go into the details. But this is a conical pendulum. What Hooke was working with Huygens. This was the time when people were studying the pendulum very closely. And he didn't want the pendulum, as it would go back and forth, and it would introduce then a kind of periodic motion into this mechanism. So instead, he said, let's take a conical pendulum, let the pendulum turn like this, and that's going to be your clock. It's going to turn a worm gear, which is going to turn this, and that's how we'll track the sky. And then we have our sextant here with our two telescopes on it, so we can measure the angle between two stars as this whole thing is tracking the sky. Well, nobody built this, and one can perhaps see why. However, somebody built something else that looks fairly close. Tompkins, who was, by the end of the 17th century, the best clockmaker in London, was hired by Flamsteed to make, at Greenwich, the newly established observatory, to make an equatorial mount. And here we see, we don't know again whether this is actually how it looks, but here is the polar axis going down into some kind of support. There was no clock on this, so one had to swing it around yourself. Then here is the sextant, and here is one telescope, and then on the back side here is the other telescope. And so you set this thing into motion, and presumably one person's going to sort of follow the track the sky with it, and then you've got two other observers here who are looking through these telescopes to be able to measure the angle in the plane. So this thing has a kind of universal ball joint on it, so you can tip the sextant so it's in the plane between the two target stars, and then you measure the distance between them. Hooke claimed to be the inventor of this, even though Tompkins said, no, I did it, not Hooke. Well, Flamsteen writes about this in his Historia Celestis, his 1725 book, this big controversial book about his star catalog. And he says that this thing didn't work very well, that you have errors more than one arc minute as the quadrant moved. And this kind of screw mechanism to turn here was supposed to be calibrated so that you turn crank and it's so many degrees or so many minutes. And he said that didn't work either. And so essentially, there was very little, if any, published data that came out of this equatorial mount. But nonetheless, they tried. Well, the next equatorial that's going to hit Greenwich was made by the instrument maker George Graham, sometime before 1738. Here is a plate that was in a book on practical astronomy published in 1738. We know nothing more about this, but it seemed to belong to Bradley, who was like the third astronomer royal, and Bradley took it in 1742 to Greenwich when he went there, and it was mounted something this. So here's the equatorial mount, and then you have, again, a kind, they call it a sector. This can only move 6 degrees. And this was used to locate comets or to locate planets by measuring the distance between very close stars, is what you do with this. So you could not sort of systematically measure long, big angles between stars, but you could measure close things in. And you see that the telescope, in sort of what you might call moving in declination, is actually has its axis, or its pivot is not on the axis. So this is actually continuing in the Hooke Tompkins tradition of being able to have this sextant that can sort of float around the sky in any angle, as opposed to being locked into the declination axis here. It had no regulator, so again, this has to be turned by hand. It has a small telescope on it. It was portable, so that Bradley would set this up. If you've been to Greenwich, there's the so-called octagon room that has all these windows, and you would just move this around to different windows to look out. But its major reverse standing, it was small. You could only support a very small telescope here, about maybe a 2-inch lens there. And so when Mescalin became the Astronomer Royal in the 1770s, so this was there at Greenwich, we don't know if it was used very much, Mescalin said, no, this isn't going to work. I need to get something bigger. Okay, so you have then in the 18th century this tradition of thinking about equatorial mounts, but none of the technology seemed to work very well. It either was not precise enough, or it was very small, and you were starting to want to have bigger telescopes. Well, the next place in the 18th century then where the equatorial mount starts to become worked out in detail are what you might call for the hobby market, even though in the 18th century, drawing distinctions between professional astronomers and amateurs is not a good category because people were doing both things. But essentially, this was a whole set of apparatus that was made by London's instrument-making craft. By the 18th century, you start to have specialized craftsmen who make scientific instruments and make astronomical instruments. They can divide angles, they can make lenses, they can, you know, build those kind of things. And many of them in the 18th century would offer something like this to sort of sit on a table and maybe pedagogically sort of teach you about the important circles and planes in the sky. Or, you know, you can do some observing with this as well. So this is from James Short, who was one of the first of these London makers, 1749. And he says in reporting this that the reason why he did this, as opposed to an alt-azimuth mount, is that he wanted his users to be able to find RA and declination directly, as opposed to having to calculate it. Right? If you just are measuring altitudes in azimuths, that's not going to give you RA and dec, where here you can read them right off of the scales. So the reverse salient here you might call is computational. You want to try to make a technology that will let you solve this problem directly. Another mount that is, this is perhaps the earliest extant mount that we have. This is in the Museum of History of Technology or something like that up in Edinburgh. It was made by John Miller, who was the leading instrument maker in Edinburgh in the 1760s and 1770s. He made this. It went and was used by somebody named James Lind. And James Lind was this very erratic physician who was the model for Frankenstein in Mary Shelley's Frankenstein book. He observed the 1769 transit of Venus with this apparatus. So it was actually used to do some astronomy. Well, there's more examples. And these are all the leading instrument makers in the 18th century. So Nairn has a portable equatorial mount. Ramsden has one, 1773. Here's one by Troughton. And this was actually used by Struve. Struve's first double, not this in particular, but this design was used by Struve in his early double star measurement. Here's another one by George Adams. And Adams actually says in his description that, well, you can actually do this, but it's actually easier to flip the equatorial axis down to be your horizon and just use it as an alt az machine. In other words, that's what people were familiar with, and he wanted to make sure that that you could do that. Anyway, so you have this long tradition. These were probably built and were used. We have them nicely illustrated, but I found no evidence that there's any sort of technological move from these tabletop devices into the systems that were developed to be using by working researchers in the big observatories. So I think this is sort of a separate, this portable mounts are a separate tradition. But let's go back to Greenwich now and to Mescalin. So Mescalin comes in the 1770s. He looks at the small Graham equatorial mount and he says, no, I want something bigger. And so he goes to Jeremiah Sisson, who again is one of the leading London makers, and in 1773 ordered two mounts. So he bought two of the identical instrument here, and it started out as a sector with just this where you could only move it about 6 or 7 degrees, and then by 1780, Mescalin said, no, I want to be able to move in dec more amount, and so they actually put this kind of a telescope on it here. The objectives were made by Dolland, 4-inch objectives, so we're starting to get, you know, a somewhat larger telescope. The Greenwich ones are all gone. One of them was abandoned in 1811. The other one was given to Herschel and Short, where they did something else with it here. And this never worked very well because the polar axis was very unstable. Sisson sold another one down to Milan, the Brie Observatory, and it is still extant. So here you can see they have the design of the sector, so you can only move in declination this amount. And then here is this sort of hollow tin tube that was used as your polar mount. And what Mescalin said was that was simply unstable. This was used in Italy up through Schiaparelli in the 1870s used this, and he complained bitterly. He says that when you use a micrometer screw, the whole machine trembles, and you use faith in the observations that you have made. So you could follow the sky, but it was not very stable. Ramsden tried without success to stabilize this, and it didn't work. Well, things get even wilder as we move to other examples. So here is Ramsden and Schuckberg develop this design. Essentially what Ramsden is doing He was very good at making transit circles. So this was this kind of circle with a telescope on it. Remember I showed you the earlier picture of one that he made in the 1780s. This was how you made transit telescopes. And what the London makers tended to do was simply take that same design and then mount it on a long polar axis. So it's an example of how technological innovation happens. You rarely develop a new machine with everything new. Instead, you take old things and you just tweak one little part of it. And so all the makers knew how to make these circles. What they didn't know how to do was make the polar axis here. So Shuckburgh had a private observatory up close to Birmingham. He ordered this in 1781, and the design was by Shuckburgh himself. So Ramsden did the circle, but this design with this kind of yoke going up to hold this was designed by Shuckburgh. It took Ramsden 10 years to make this, and Ramsden was terrible. He always took, his delivery times were very long. You'd order something from him and you'd wait a long time. This guy waited 10 years for it. And this is the first example of what's going to be called the English mount. So Airy's the one who's going to give us the words, the English mount and the German mount. And this is an example of an English mount, which has the telescope in the middle, and then the polar axis has to be supported down at the bottom, and then by some kind of a very tall support that's going to go up to give you the inclination you need for your latitude. This was Ramsden's largest equatorial. When it was mounted, it was called a colossus here. Well, Shuckburgh and Ramsden had worked together on some other things, so they knew each other. As far as I can tell, there were no published observations that were taken by Shuckburgh and his observatory, and there's not even any archival material left. So we don't have a clue if he was able to use this to actually look at anything here. He tried to give it to Oxford. After he died, they didn't want it, so it went to Greenwich, and it got mounted in Greenwich, and they built a special dome for it here. So here it's mounted in Greenwich. Here you see this long yoke piece that goes to support the top. And the yoke is missing, but this is what it looks like now. I saw it just a couple months ago in the Science Museum. And it looks like a tinsmith's nightmare. This is all made out of tin. These are not solid bars. These are tubes of brass. And it's got these kind of spokes. Again, this looks like a mural transit that has been put in the middle of this axis. Note the design is to have all the axes centered on each other. He doesn't want to have counterweights, so everything has to be in the middle. So that means you've got to put the telescope somehow in the middle of your axis. Now, what the German mount is going to say is, that's a bad idea. But they did not know that then. Anyway, so this was highly criticized. The framework was too slender for the length of the polar axis. It remains at Greenwich. This is somebody writing in 1829. This remains at Greenwich. A proof of its former proprietor's munificence rather than of its maker's success in the strength and stability of the essential parts. So it's proof that this guy was rich and could spend money on the brass. It's not proof that he knew anything about engineering. Well, my next story is even more far-fetched. And this is one that Michael Hoskin, a colleague, has written a wonderful paper called The Astronomer's War about this design. This started in 1795, and it's going to have a life through into the 1820s. So the story begins with somebody called Captain Joseph Huddart. He was a fellow of the Royal Society. He was a hydrographic engineer. He was the person who surveyed the Hebrides and some of these islands down in the South Pacific. And then he came back to England and he invented a steam engine machine to manufacture rope. And by doing that, he became the Bill Gates of his time. British Admiralty needed a lot of rope, and he could make rope cheap, so he had a lot of money and was an amateur astronomer. And so he designed this and he did his own tin work. So this looks sort of like a canoe. This is a big piece of tin and for the axis. And then it's got a hole in the middle, of course. And then there's a circle here that pivots for the declination, and you put your telescope in that. And again, it's got this kind of yoke structure to support the polar axis. The Dahlen brothers made the objective, with 4-inch objective, achromat, and Huddart used this as a transit instrument. It wouldn't work if it was out of the meridian. And so he basically kept it in his house as a transit instrument for 20 years, and used it. Again, he published nothing, and there are no archival materials. So he was a good tinsmith. He was a good rope maker. He didn't do very much in terms of astronomy. Well, he is going to die in 1816, and then James South enters the story. I don't know if James South is a household name, but if you want to read about a cantankerous, interesting guy, read about James South. He was one of the founders of the Royal Astronomical Society in London, and was a well-known double star observer. His most important work was working with John Herschel on double stars, but he was also a well-known critic and general troublemaker. He married a rich woman in 1816, and the first thing he did was took her money to buy this telescope here, and moved it down to his private observatory in Kensington. It's just sort of to the west of Buckingham Palace is where he had, there's a little hill there, Camden Hill, and that's where he set this thing up. Built big brick piers to support these two, the polar axis, and he said the right ascension motion does not disturb at all that in deck, nor does the deck affect the other. These properties are most essential to facilitate and render accurate micrometrical observations, i.e. double stars. And he said you could not do this if you look at some of the other kinds of stands, these portable stands. So he says, I want to have an equatorial mount that is going to be big and firm. And this was used by Herschel then and South in 1821 to 24 to remeasure doubles, right? So that William Herschel had done the first doubles catalog in the 1780s, and now this was 30 years later, and you want to measure them again because you want to, the big question was, are doubles physical doubles or are they accidental doubles? And so you want to see if there is motion, and to do that you have to take observations over this time span. So this was really important work, and this is the first time when they proved that there were physical doubles that you had proof of gravity working out in the, you know, away from the solar system. So this was a very important work, and they used this kind of thing. By 1926, South publishes, they find 160 new doubles, but then he says that the objective on their telescope was too small, and he wanted to get a bigger objective because he wanted to compete with Struve. My story is getting a little bit mixed up now. Struve is already publishing doubles with his Dorpat refractor, and Struve is finding a lot more because he can see fainter than South can. And so he says that he needs an instrument more powerful and more appropriate for double stars so he can compete with Struve. Well, so he goes to Fraunhofer. He knows about the Dorpat refractor, and Fraunhofer has a 12-inch objective that's all ready to go. 12 inches would have been the biggest glass objective at that time, the world's biggest glass. He's offering it to South. But Fraunhofer says, I will only sell it to you if you buy my German mount. And Short says, no, I don't want that mount. It's way too expensive. And indeed, Fraunhofer's mount was very expensive. And so he said, just sell me the glass. And Fraunhofer said, no. So then what he did, he went to Paris, South did, and he bought another 12-inch objective that was made by Couchois. It was actually 12 and a half, and that was the biggest glass. And of course, Arago was really mad because the French wanted to keep this, but instead it comes to England. And so Short then goes to Troughton and says, okay, I've got this bigger glass, I'm gonna make a bigger tube. Can you build me another one of these mounts and just scale it up? And Troughton, the English very good mechanical engineer, said no. Scaling this up is not going to work. That you're going to have all kinds of problems. He can't guarantee that it's going to be secure. And this started this big war, this big fight between them. A contract was made, and Troughton designed a new polar axis that has to be one of the wackiest ideas. He basically had two elliptical strips of brass. And that is, and with sort of some X's between them, and that's what's going to mount the star. So you're turning this big ellipse of these bent brass rods around the axis here. And of course, these things are going to twist as you turn it. It's not going to be stable at all here. So they set it up, this thing. It did not work at all. Short got very angry with this, and part of the anger arose as to what should be the goal of this. It actually became a public, they carried on the debate on the pages of the New York Times, of the London Times. They would write letters back and forth to each other. Charles Babbage, who was known for his incendiary public publications criticizing the state of English science, got involved in this and criticized Troughton for developing these kind of things. And what Troughton said was, look, you're looking at double stars. The key thing you want to measure in a double star is their separation and the angle of the separation. You don't care where you are in RA and DEC. That doesn't matter. So let this thing swing around. It doesn't matter. You can measure the position of the star with another telescope. But Babbage said, no, if you're going to make a good telescope, it's got to have good DEC and RA. And so sort of the fight was, what do you really need here? Well, so there's this big public discussion in the pages of the London Times about elasticity and about the stiffness of brass that was going on here, not the kind of thing you're normally used to seeing in the newspaper, which is about politics. South actually went to Dorpat to go look at Struve's telescope to see if he could get some examples there. Anyway, finally, he refused to pay. South did. He called it a useless pile of junk. Babbage called it an entire failure. It went to court. The court said that Troughton had to be paid £8,000. And so South had a lot of money. He paid him. But then he got back at him, and he took a hammer and smashed the mount to pieces and had a big auction in 1829 where he says, to be sold, all this junk, being the polar axis of the great equatorial instrument made by Troughton and Sims. So say, if you're a telescope maker, that's how you get a good reputation, right? Here's this £8,000 that this guy's just paid. He smashed it to pieces, and now he's trying to sell it. He sold it for £6 to the scrap dealers here. That was an equatorial mount that didn't work. Well, just to finish up looking at a couple other examples, Troughton made another one. This was actually earlier that he made for the Church's Observatory. The Church of Ireland had their own observatory. In the 1780s, and they ordered an equatorial, and as you can see, it's got these kind of looks like Ramsden-esque. Here's the transit circle, and then rather than having those two hoops, he's now got a kind of pyramid shape with four brass tubes to give it stability. This looks to me like it'd be much more stable than the hoop thing, but he didn't do this. Again, this was something that no published work came out of, and in Armagh, when they started the annals of the Armagh Observatory, the first one, they always describe all their apparatus. They don't say a word about this in 1829. In other words, it's as if it didn't exist, and no published data came from this. Well, it's not just the English who do this. Reichenbach in Munich made an equatorial for Naples, and again, you see it has the support of the axis at the top. Look at this counterweight, though. That's going to look familiar. Struve knew about this, and it had a clock drive on it, and it wasn't properly counterweighted, the clock drive did not work very well, and of course this big pylon here keeps you from looking at a lot of the sky in this direction. So Struve definitely had this in the back of his mind as he was designing his instrument. But this is still the English mount. Okay, well this takes us then to the heart of my story, and I'll try to wrap this up fairly soon. These are the instructions. So this single engraving is all that Struve had. That came in one of the 22 boxes when he put his instrument together. So he had to unpack all those boxes and figure out where things go from this drawing here. Let me say a bit about Struve. He had been appointed the professor of mathematics and astronomy in 1813 at this little university, Dorpat. That was part of Russia. And so that the ministry was actually in St. Petersburg, and that's part of the problem when I work in the archives. Struve writes in German to St. Petersburg, and then the St. Petersburg people write back in Russian. And I can't read Russian, so I've got to find a colleague to let us work on that. Anyway, he began transit work, new observatory that the Russians funded. They wanted to sort of support science. And he did what every new observatory does. You set up a transit telescope, and you simply start measuring stars. That's what he began with. But already by 1814, he started to take notes of when he saw a double star. And he saw 56 double stars in the first year. He would just estimate by eye what the difference was between them. In 1818, he started to note doubles more seriously. And in 1819, then, he used this small portable Troughton equatorial to actually, with a micrometer, to actually start measuring separations and to measuring the angles here. To become a doubles observer. And indeed, he and Bessel are sort of working at the same time, right? Bessel's going to be the person who gets stellar parallax from a double first. But measuring doubles was sort of the front of the research at this time. It's moving from positional work to now starting to do what I call natural history as opposed to simply positions. Right? If you're looking at doubles, you're trying to say that stars are more than just little points. You want to learn something else. You have to start to look at them and spend time with stars as individual objects. And it's Herschel and Short and Bessel and Struve who are the four people who are going to launch this part of astronomy. Well, so Struve is up and coming. He's publishing this work. He's publishing these doubles. He's writing in Latin. The people in London complain they can't read it. But he gets enough attention that he's able to persuade the ministry in St. Petersburg to give him money to go down and talk to the people in Munich about ordering a big telescope. And he takes a five-month trip, and this is very typical for what you would do when you're going to launch an observatory. You want to visit other observatories, talk to instrument makers, get a sense as to who is doing the best work, and then you get that experience together to make yours. So he went to Königsberg, where he saw Bessel. He went to Hamburg. He went to Göttingen, where he saw Gauss. He went to Gotha, where there was a private observatory, and then he went to Munich in the summer of 1820. And he ordered instruments primarily for doing the cadastral survey of Livland, of Estonia. This was the first survey of this western part of Russia. And that's the state was giving most of the money for that. But to do that, you also had to know your longitude and latitude, so you needed a big telescope to do that. So he visited the optical shops of Fraunhofer and Utzschneider, and he visited the mechanical shops there. He saw Reichenbach. He says Reichenbach is a very good mechanic, has a very good spirit of discovery. He ordered a micrometer to use for double star work from Fraunhofer. And then he saw two big objectives, 12-inch objectives that Fraunhofer had done. And that's where he had the idea, okay, I want to have a big equatorial-mounted telescope with these. It would cost 8,000 gulden. Now, 8,000 gulden was a lot of money. I think it was like one-third of the whole university budget was this amount of money for this telescope. But he was able to persuade the Russian government to do this. He brought back the micrometer and started measuring doubles again. And in his published work, there's no indication that he's finding reverse salients in this. Now, what I'm trying to look at is I look at what astronomers are complaining about, and then how they're going to then reduce those reduced salients by working with their instrument makers. And I've not found Struve complaining. He just wants this bigger thing. But there's a lot of his correspondence that I've not looked at yet, and so I'm hoping in the correspondence I'm going to find it. So we don't know very much, and this is my problem. I'm trying to figure out. We don't know very much about how Fraunhofer is going to design this new mount. There was never a mount before that was done like this. Right? We'll look at the piece. You don't have a long polar axis, you have a short polar axis. And the telescope is going on top of the axis, right? That's a completely different way to do this. And what I want to try to figure out is how Fraunhofer and Struve came to this design. Now, we have a lot of Fraunhofer materials in the archives. There's only two or three letters between Struve and Fraunhofer, and they're just about money. They're not about, engineering problems here. Anyway, He gets this thing, and Fraunhofer then makes a public lecture about it, and he talks about some of the obstacles. He uses the word hindrance, the German word obstacle, for what they had to overcome, which are reverse salients. He said that the problem, you can't use an old azimuth because you can't adjust both axes at the same time to follow at high magnifications. He says even if you have a parallactic mount, even an equatorial mount, if you have to turn it by hand, you can't turn smoothly. Because most of the way you would turn these things, right, the wheels are way up high, and so you'd have a rod coming down with a universal joint in it. Hooke actually invented the universal joint. And the problem was, every 180 degrees, that universal joint bends. And so if you're turning this smoothly, that doesn't mean the telescope's going to move smoothly. So Fraunhofer says, you have to have a clock for this. You have to have counterweights. The only way a clock is going to work is to have this thing be as balanced as precisely as possible. And you have to do that with counterweights. You can't just center everything. The German mount doesn't let you center everything. The axes are going to be off from each other, so you have to have counterweights. He said the Bavarian glass is going to improve the English glass, and that was true. Fraunhofer had the best glass in the world at that time. You needed the clock drive, he said, and you needed to be able to adjust the optical axes of both the objective and the eyepiece so you can line them up. And previous telescopes had not had that before, where you could sort of independently adjust these things. Well, so let's just look closely now at this restored, the Dorpat refractor. It was restored by Paolo Brini, who is a leading instruments historian, works at the Museo Galileo in Florence, lives in Paris most of the time, very good with his hands, and he's the person who did the restoration. Anyway, this is the heart of the regulator, of the clock. And the way the speed is controlled in terms of the governor, right, the problem is that if there is any imbalance, right, the clock's going to have to work harder sometimes than others, but you don't want it to slow down, right? You want to keep the clock going at the same place. So you have to somehow, just like a governor on a steam engine, you have to be able to control the speed. And the way he did that was to make a kind of conical cylinder here. So this is a little piece about this big. You have one up in the observatory that was an imitation done just a few years ago. And then these little balls, so this thing is spinning with the clock, and these little balls rub against the edge by friction. And as they go faster or slower, that makes the friction be less or more, and that's a way to regulate the speed. As far as I know, no clockmaker had ever done this before. This is an invention of Fraunhofer and Struve, somehow to regulate the speed. Also, because it's conical, it means that let's say you're not tracking the sky, but if you're tracking the sun or the moon, right, you have to have a different speed. And all you do is move this shaft up and down, and that's going to then hit the cone at a different place, and that lets you then adjust the speed of this clock to match something that is moving. So here's the way it looks. There's the worm gear. So this is that little device with the balls inside. Here's where the clock drive is. You put the weights coming down here. It turns this worm, and that worm then turns the bottom of your axis here to do the motion. But the key thing that makes it all work are the counterweights. If you're going to have this clock drive this thing. The whole telescope weighs 2,500 kilograms. The tube itself and the glass on top is at least, maybe 200-300 kilograms. You have to have it balanced. And if you remember that Reichenbach sort of counterweight, he had something like this. So we're going to see more about this. But this is how you balance the tube. Here's the tube on the weight, and then you have this massive weight over here. This is the top of the polar axis. And so, the whole thing is trying to tip, right? So there's tremendous, much more friction on the bottom of this bearing than on the top of this bearing. And so, again, what Reichenbach and Fraunhofer invented is this counterweight with these two wheels. So these two wheels push against the shaft, and the counterweight pulls down, which pushes this up, and therefore that relieves some of the weight off the bottom of the bearing. It's a very clever design. This is not about grease, right? This is brass against steel here. There's no lubricant in there. That is designed with these counterweights. Anytime you see this kind of fork with this heavy weight on it, you know that's a Fraunhofer Mertz design. When I saw that on our pile of junk that I had found at Dartmouth a few years ago, I said, oh my gosh, that's the original mount, because they were the only people that did that. So then you also have to have counterweights for the objective, right? You can't. For something like this, you don't want to mount the tube in the middle, because if the tube's in the middle, then it's going to come down and hit the floor. Then you have to make this higher. And so you mount it off-center, which means you've got extra weight up here. And so he did this sort of cantilever with these counterweights that you can adjust to go around the deck axis to balance that as well. So here it is. This is the heart, really, that makes the Fraunhofer mount work. It's not in the objective. It's not, the clock drive's nice, but it's in the way these counterweights work. So here's the tube, and then here is the frame that goes off to this long counterweight over here that's going to balance tipping on this axis. This is the counterweight that is going to balance the tube, and then here are those two wheels that are going to take the pressure off the bearing at the top. This piece of mechanical engineering is, I think, wonderfully interesting, and my project is try to figure out how they did this. Is there existing technology that was used for some other machine at the time? I don't know the answer to this question yet. But this is the secret that let that clock drive work, is that you can put a big telescope, relatively speaking, with a very weak little clock, and you can drive it, because with this system here, everything can be balanced. Okay, so the question is that I want to try to sort out in this project is to what extent can I figure out details of how the engineering work went into this mount, how Struve and Fraunhofer, or maybe Reichenbach as well, the people down in Munich and up in Dorpat, how they collaborated to design this thing. And in the printed documentation, I've not found evidence of that. So my work over the next, when I get time, is to go into the archives and see what I can learn there. So my questions are, is this notion of reverse salients, how widely applicable is it going to be for a problem like this? Is that the right way, theoretically, to think about how this technological system was developed? And if I look at other astronomers at the same time who were dealing with these, trying to struggle with these equatorial mounts, can I find in their correspondence or their interactions with their instrument makers other examples of problems and how they tried to sort them out? Can I construct what I call a sort of taxonomy of complaints for looking at telescope design circa 1800, right when astronomy was getting ready to take off? And the whole goal is, well, I want to learn about interactions between makers and users of this technology. And then I'm going to look also at this German mount as being what then enables double star observations to take off. So stellar parallax gets discovered, and suddenly people start working out actually orbital periods of double stars. And it comes from this mount, because there's no way, if you don't have an equatorial mount, there's really no way to adjust your micrometer and measure to, they were measuring, Struve was measuring to the hundredths of an arc second. He could read his micrometer to the hundredths of an arc second in measuring the separation of double stars. And that takes time. You can't just, you know, adjust this thing if the sky is moving by there. So I think that double star astronomy, which is going to be one of the big threads of the beginning of what I call the natural history that moves into astronomy in the 19th century, is going to be possible because of the development of this German mount. So that's where the project is going. I'll come back in a few years and I'll tell you what my answers are if I've had a chance to get into the archives to see about these interactions. And of course, after Dorpat, Fraunhofer sold a few more of these things. So in 1847, William Bond bought one for Cambridge. And this is an early illustration of what it looked like when it was installed. And you can see it's got the same kind of counterweights. This is a bit larger objective, so it's a bigger dome and a bigger pier. But it's got the same counterweight out here. If you look closely, it's got the same, here's the counterweight with the yoke to support the top of the polar axis. So the design is the same. The clock's on the other side. You can't quite see it. But it turns out that Owen and I were looking at this earlier today, and that Bond complained that the clock drive did not scale up. So that when you build this bigger thing, you know, you increase this by 20%, that's going to increase the mass of the whole system by a lot more. And even with perfect or well balancing, there's still a lot of momentum in moving this thing, and you only get so much power out of these clocks. So that Bond complained that he could not follow the sky. Struve said his instrument followed the sky perfectly, right? The star would stay right in the middle of the field for a long time. That would not happen here. And so what the Bonds had to do was get the Clarks, the instrument makers in Cambridgeport, and if you go up and look at the pier, there's actually some holes here where they mounted another clock. They redesigned the clock drive. It's not there anymore. The Clark's clock drive is gone. But that was a way to try to keep this so that it would track because it's a larger instrument. So the point is, as you move into the 19th century then, and as observatories get bigger, and as telescopes get bigger, there's going to be more and more reverse salients, and sort of the story of how that engineering and an astronomical knowledge work together is getting more and more complicated. I probably don't have time to do that. So instead of what I want to focus on is this early period when people were trying to figure out how to build an equatorial mount that would support a big telescope. The English design was tried for 100 years, they could not produce the kind of mechanical stability that the German design was able to do. And so if I can figure out sort of how the German design was put together, what the technological predecessors were of that, I hope to have something new to say for the history of 19th century and the history of the telescope. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Rich, and delighted that it ended up with the dome over here, and you can go up and see that telescope with new eyes, all of the leveraging the weight controls and so on. So you've opened our eyes to something local, as well as giving a very interesting account of how the mounting has interacted with where astronomy could go.
And I moved both of them. I moved the one in Dorpat, the restored. I moved yours, and it takes at least 10 times more force to move this one than it does the one in Dorpat. But that might be a function of their current state of restoration.
A little bit re-greasing, and it'll be better. All right, we have the possibility for you to ask questions.
I have a question. Do you know how did they actually design the things? Did they have the calculus or was it all trial and error? So they made some devices, the prototype that failed, and they changed something? Because I'm not sure they had any theory, scientific theory, that they could use to compute and calculate things in advance for the engineering part.
Well, they certainly did trial and error, but it wasn't just trial and error. I mean, you remember that Galileo, in 1638, published a book on the strength of materials, and he actually did things about bending, where he would take a beam and support it and develop a kind of theory about how things bend and where they break. So there was a kind of, I mean, it wasn't, you know, based on fundamental theory, but there was a kind of engineering sense as to how metals worked and how stresses would be sent through a machine that you might call was theoretical. And so they knew some of that. But Fraunhofer himself was completely uneducated. I mean, the story of Fraunhofer is that he was this peasant boy who there was a fire, and he went in and he saved somebody's life, and he was 13 years old pulling out the fire. And the Bavarian king happened to be riding by at the same time, and said, "Who's that kid?" And that was Fraunhofer's life. He was plucked into the court. Turns out he was very good with his hands, and he became this great instrument maker, but he never went to school a day in his life and never attended a university. So as to whether Fraunhofer knew about these engineering treatises written in Latin, that is probably not the case. But it's very hard. This was proprietary information. This is secret stuff, right? So Fraunhofer and his glassmaker, right? Fraunhofer had this Swiss glassmaker that he swore to secrecy. The glassmaker was not even to write anything down, because the English and the Bavarians were doing tremendous industrial espionage. So they'd send over some visitor to come and ask, you know, "Can I come and look at your glassworks?" And it would be a spy from Birmingham, and they were all worried about this. So we don't know to this day how Fraunhofer made some of this glass. So they weren't, like, sort of, that's part of my problem. I'm trying to understand the engineering of this, and you're not going to find it in the published work, because they want to keep this secret, because that's money in the bank.
So the question is whether they wrote it down at all.
That's right. So I want to look at the other stuff Fraunhofer made, the other stuff Reifenbach made, and to look at the kind of machines that would have these massive axes, and sort of, you know, think about, you know, do you have counterweights in clocks? Do you have counterweights in steam engines? Sort of what other kind of machines, circa 1800, would have had these kind of mechanical issues that they might have been able to learn from?
So was there a German precision machine tool industry? Was it Swiss at that point?
Swiss were making the clocks.
So but, these clocks were all German, though.
But this was German. Munich was the center. Napoleon is good for science. So Napoleon defeats Bavaria, and they sort of say, "Oh my gosh, we're just a nation of peasants. If we want to compete on the European stage, we need to have science and technology." And so the state starts to intervene, and you get the first National Science Foundation is invented by in 1805, when the French were still there, by the Bavarians, and they start to fund crafts. Mm-hmm. And fund mechanics to develop the technological infrastructure of the nation. So Fraunhofer was publicly supported. It wasn't just that he had to sell telescopes for 8,000 gulden. So they were systematically trying to enhance their craft skills, especially in metalworking. And I would say that probably in the German-speaking areas in Munich in 1810s, 1820s, that was where the best skill was. It would be Munich, it would be London, it would be Paris. Those three places were the three best places to do metalworking in the world.
What do you know about the machines that were used to produce the telescope? That might actually be an interesting source of...
I have a good friend. You know Michael Wright in London.
I know who he is.
Michael Wright was a mechanic himself who worked at the Science Museum for a long time. And he's the guy who built the first working model of the anti-shifter mechanism. So he's very good with his hands. And he has in his backyard, his shop, that has lathes from 1810 and 1820. He will not work on a modern lathe. He does his work. He built the anti-kithler mechanism with a pedal lathe that you move your foot, and it spins, and you can do the metal cutting. So they had lathes that were run by either, you know, your foot or some kid you hired to make your lathe go, and that's how they did it. You know, these gears are, the Fraunhofer gears are just beautiful. And they were all cut on these hand lathes. So, you know, look at that. I've not measured them, but clockmakers were very good at, you know, this kind of thing, cutting gears, people were very good at that. I'm working with some people in Dresden right now. They've got this big astronomical clock from 1850, 1860, and there's a debate as to whether the solar eccentricity is built into the gearing so that you actually have different separations of the gears, and we measured it, and it is amazing. They put the eccentricity in, and so there's variations of hundreds of millimeters systematically around how the gear spacing is, so that you can have the variable speed. You can have one wheel that represents the sun, and it has variable speed as it goes around. So these people were good with their hands, good with files, good with they could build very, very precise brass material with all the handwork that they had.
I guess my point was that the same techniques that go into making a stiff and accurate machine tool have a lot to do with how you would design these things, because the English things look like someone who was completely unfamiliar with what a machine tool would look like and how to use it and what makes it stiff. I mean, the engineering is of a totally different caliber in this telescope.
Yeah, you have the sense that the English were tinsmiths. I mean, so look at this. Now, these are tubes. Now, notice this. There's a taper in these. Rams didn't realize that if you have a spoke and if you put a taper on it, it's going to be stiffer than if it's parallel. And my engineering friends tell me there's ways to prove this, actually. And so this was a sign that he wanted to get, you know, for less weight, because he wants to make this not massy, because then it's easier to turn. So he wants to get this, as much strength as he can with the reduced weight, and so he invents this taper. And all of the circles that Ramson has, and the English people follow him, follow this taper. Now what's interesting is you go to, we just saw it up here on this, the polar axis here, or you can't see it. This here has a taper on it. That's a solid rod. There's a taper of about an inch. It's an inch wider here than it is here. And the one that you have up here has that same taper on it. And that also is based on experience. You want to make this axis be as stiff as it can be. And so you do a taper on it to make it stiffer. Now, they knew that. I don't think that's in any books. But if you find a rod that needs to be strong in the late 18th or the 19th century, it's going to have this taper on it. Yes.
Are these bearings brass on brass, or do we have...
No, it's brass on steel. It's always, all the weight bearing is brass on steel. And right here, the whole weight of the telescope is right against that pivot. And that is simply a piece of steel turning on a piece of brass. Without any grease.
No grease.
No grease, no.
Experience. When was the ball bearing or roller bearing?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know if there's ball bearings in this little thing here. But I'm guessing it's sometime in the 19th century. But this doesn't have any of those in it. There's a question here? Yes?
Yeah, in terms of your salient idea, isn't it maybe true that Williams Herschel's 20-foot had to break a couple salients, or reverse salients? His idea was he wanted to look at very faint, extended things.
Yeah.
And the way to do that, you have to have a lot of aperture, but you couldn't make a piece of glass that has sufficient aperture to see the nebulae. So you have to go to mirrors, but then you couldn't mount a mirror on any kind of mouse that were existing for the typical refractor, so you have to design a whole different kind of structure, even though it was FDAS. That was kind of a breakthrough, I thought.
No, I think that's right. I mean, I think this reverse salient idea is a nice way to look at the history of instrumentation. Is that he wanted to get more light gathering power. That was his reverse salient, right? Those little 4-inch telescopes would not give him enough to see far enough. And so you go bigger, and then you have all these other problems.
Right, so you have to develop technology to make big mirrors, which wasn't existing at the time. Plus, realize you have to have a mount that can handle the big mirrors, because the current technology didn't allow for that. And then you have to figure out the optics for how to get up there, because You know, if you're up at the end of the tube and looking in, you don't want to block any of the aperture, so you have to figure out...
We were just talking about this, right? Do you tilt the axis?
Tilt the axis.
Off to the side. And then you have to make a polishing apparatus to polish this? And he tried to scale it up, right? He tried to make his 40-footer,
that didn't work.
Right there, he could not take the technology and scale it up until the 40-footer just sat there. And he didn't do any science with that. So I think you could go through a lot of telescope history. You could probably take it into the 20th century and look at how satellite systems and things were developed. And again, sort of try to identify, you know, are there sort of reverse salients that sort of go through time, different reverse salients as you're trying to make more and more complicated systems. The question is whether this sort of analytical tool is a way to help you unpack sort of where the innovation really happens in developing these new observing technologies.
So do we know what the Clarks did? They obviously had to do something. Where did they do anything more than scale up the clock drive?
Well, Owen and I, we were looking at a photograph and trying to figure this out. Owen thinks he understands it. I don't think I do. So we're still working on this. But I don't think the Clarks published it. So we don't. Whatever their solution was, it's not in any publication that I know of. But this is something that we're going to have to try to.
Would there be drawings in the communications somewhere? No.
A couple of photographs, and that's it. And they're not very detailed.
But we do have Clark correspondence that, you know, is in Chicago at the Adler, and I've looked at it for other questions, but I've not looked at it for this question, so maybe I'll see if I can track it down. But again, these guys didn't write about this. I mean, they would like to keep this under their hat.
Yeah, so my interest is how this, it seems like a lot of the mechanics would come from the clock making, the actual large clock making, but possibly even the smaller clock making technology that existed in Switzerland, Germany, and then came across the ocean. And I come from the Midwest, where our local watch company was made possible by a bunch of people stealing technology from the Waltham Watch Company.
Yeah.
And so I know about, like, sort of firsthand, since my family's worked at that place for generations. That's how things work. The mills in Rhode Island came from the mills in England, and people just stole technology. I mean, so that whole thing about technology happened here a lot.
Well, what's interesting about London, and we don't know that much about Munich, the craft scene in Munich has not been studied that much, because there was more of it in London. But in London, what they found in the 18th century as it started was that it was delocalized. So makers would specialize on doing certain things. So I make screws, and I make wooden cases. And I make glass, and somebody else does the foundry, does the brass. You wouldn't have soup to nuts in one shop.
Right.
But instead, they'd go down the street, and Fleet Street was one of these places, and you'd send your boy down and say, okay, go get me 15 screws. And he'd go get 15 screws. And so the thing that you'd have somebody's name on it, Tompkinen, most of those parts were not made by Tompkinen. They're made by somebody else. And he put it together.
Well, that's still true here. The machine tool industry in New England is like that now. There are lots of little companies. We don't think we have a manufacturing industry because it's not in the cities. It's out away and decentralized a lot. And it's still there, a lot of it, that started off making tools for mills, and now they make more sophisticated things. So I think that it will happen anywhere you have a center like that. And it sounds like Germany, because it was done with state sponsorship so much, maybe they... but I wonder if that's true in Switzerland. It's different there.
I don't know, but mills are another place to look for me to get ideas about where the engineering was invented. So I want to look at steam machines and then look at mills. Where any place there's big machinery that's going to have counterweights to see whether or not maybe there were sort of existing solutions that all Fraunhofer did is move it from A to B and put it on a telescope mount. That would be nice if that would be the case. But nobody's ever said that before. There's been a lot of work on Fraunhofer. But he is, among the Germans, sort of their George Washington. I mean, he's like a holy figure. And so the sense of what the Germans said is, oh, Fraunhofer was just brilliant. And he just sat down and he invented all this stuff, because he was like the best engineer of the 19th century. And, you know, that to me is not an explanation to call somebody brilliant. That's not doing any historical work. And so they really haven't looked the way they should look. At sort of how technology was sort of swirling through this early industrializing Bavaria. Now that's too big a project for me to do. But I want to spend some time in Munich, because that's one thing that's good about Germany, is that the state keeps very good records. So if they're spending their money, they're going to keep track of where that money was going, and I'm going to be able to get to those archives. In contrast to the craftsmen at London, right? You know, there's no archival material at all. But there will be receipts and things like that.
And the Swiss are probably secretive.
And the Swiss, I've never tried to work in Switzerland, so I don't know.
Well, I think we've had a very good time this afternoon, and he'll be around a little bit longer if you want to come up and ask questions, but I think it's time for us to thank our speaker and call.